Hello and welcome to the session in which we would look at the time value of money concept. This topic is extremely important whether you are an accounting student or a finance student. On the CPA exam, you cannot pass the exam, I can assure you, FAR or BEC, unless you have a good understanding about the time value of money. The reason is simple. When it comes to the FAR section of the exam, there are many accounts such as bonds, notes payable, leases, deferred income taxes, account long-term notes receivable. They use this concept, and the assumption is you have a good understanding of this concept. On BEC, we have the finance section, and they expect you to know the concept of the time value of money. So whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, I strongly suggest you have a strong understanding about this topic before sitting for the exam. What I can do is I can help you pass the exam, CPA exam, by providing you supplemental material in addition to your CPA review course. It doesn't matter which CPA review course you are taking, Roger, Becker, Gleam, or Wiley, I can help you. My material is useful addition, is supplementary information. I explain the material differently. I show you the concept, the theory behind the concept. I don't assume you know anything, so I'm going to be explaining this topic from scratch. Your risk is 1 month of subscription if you want to give me a try. Your potential gain is passing the exam. Don't hesitate. Invest in yourself. I do have resources for whatever CPA review course you are taking, and my resources are aligned with your Becker, Roger, Gleam, whatever course you are taking. Also, I do have resources for other accounting courses as well, and if you're studying for the exam, I have all the AICPA previously released questions with detailed solution. Please connect with me on LinkedIn if you haven't done so. Take a look at my LinkedIn recommendation. Like this recording, share it with other. Connect with me on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and Reddit. The time value of money concept is extremely important. So let's go ahead and dive into it, and I'm going to explain it from scratch, from zero. So what is the idea behind the time value of concept? Simply put, a dollar received today is not the same as a dollar promised in the future. Well, what does that mean? It means if you give me a dollar today, that dollar is not the same if you give me the same dollar a week from today. Now, why? It doesn't have to be a week. It could be a month, a year. It doesn't matter. Why that's the case? Well, one reason is inflation. What is inflation? Let's assume rather than a dollar, $2. You gave me $2. $2 today, I can still buy easily a cup of coffee from a place called Wawa. Okay, easily buy a cup of coffee. Maybe a year from now, the way inflation is going, where prices are going up, if you gave me the same $2, I walk into Wawa, it's the same exact $2, I cannot buy the same cup of coffee. Why? Because of inflation. Prices went up. I lost my purchasing power. So a dollar today is worth more than a dollar a year from now, or 2 years from now, or 3 years from now. So that's what we mean by inflation. The other thing is risk. Well, if you give me the dollar today, I know I have it in my hand. A year from now, you may not exist. I don't know whether you're going to give me that dollar or not. So giving those two factors, inflation and risk, the same dollar is not worth the same. So investors need a way to compare a dollar worth today to a dollar worth into the future. Because if I'm going to invest with you, if I'm going to give you money, whether lend you money or invest money in your company, I need to compare a dollar today to a dollar into the future. I need to compare what is my dollar worth today. If I give you my dollar today, how much would you need to give me in the future? So my dollar equal to my dollar in the future. So that's what we're trying to do. So what we do is we use something called the present value or discounting or the time value concept. So this is where the time value concept. So if I'm going to give you a dollar today, let's assume I'm the lender. I want to get my money in the future, but I want to have the same principal amount that I gave you. I want to have the same amount. If I'm going to give you a dollar today, I want to receive equal value. Now, how do I compute this? How do I compute it? This is what I would use, the present value or the discounting. Now, in accounting, we have many uses of this. For example, when we're measuring the fair value of a company at level 3, we use discounted cash flow because we don't have observable market value. So simply put, we're looking at a company and there's no value, and we need to value the company today. We need to find the fair value. What we do is we look at their future cash flow. They're going to be making 100,000, 100,000, 100,000, and 100,000. That's what we projected. Then we need to know How much is the value of the company today? What we do is we discount those 100,000 to the present value to find out what's the value of the company using discounted cash flow. When we discount cash flow, this is what we would learn in this chapter, using interest rate, we discount the value, find the present value. Same concept applies when we deal with long-term liabilities, bonds, leases, notes. They are recorded at the present value of the payments. Same thing with long-term receivable. They are recorded at the present value of the receipts. So these are the uses. That's why you cannot pass the exam without knowing, understanding very well the time value of money, starting with the concept of interest. What is interest? Interest is the cost of money. You want to buy something from the store, you give them money, they give you something in return. You want to buy money? That's fine. They will give you the money, but you have to pay them interest for that. So if you borrowed $10,000, which we call the principal amount, from your bank, and you repaid $10,500 a year later, the difference between the principal, the difference between what you borrowed, called the principal, we're going to say P, and the amount repaid, the $10,500, is $500, and we call this interest. So 500 is the difference and 500 is the interest. Now we can express the interest as a percentage. So if you paid $500 for borrowing 10,000, 500 divided by 10,000, we can say that your interest is 5%. Now, how do banks determine that interest? How do they say we're going to charge you 5% interest? Well, it depends on two factors, usually. Your risk, how risky are you? I'm going to give you this money. Well, if you're too risky, I may not give you anything altogether. But what is your level of risk? Now, for individuals, that is reflected in your credit, in your credit score. Each one of us has a credit score, and companies, they also have what's called ratings. So it depends on your rating, on your risk. The higher your risk, the higher the interest rate, because they want to be compensated. If I'm going to give you money and you're a risky individual, I want to be compensated for my risk. If I want to be compensated for my risk, I'm going to charge you higher interest rate. The second factor is time. The longer I'm lending you this money for, the higher interest rate I'm going to be charging you. So simply put, higher rate, if I charge you higher rate, you're going to have higher interest payment, higher interest cost. If the amount is larger, given everything else is equal, you're going to pay more interest. The longer time it takes to repay that loan, the larger is the interest amount. So make sure you know the relationship between those three. Basically, if they're common sense, if I charge you higher interest rate, you're going to pay more in interest. If the amount that you borrowed is larger, you're going to pay a larger amount of interest, giving the same interest rate. And the longer the loan, the more interest you will pay. Let's dive a little deeper into the interest. And we're going to say we have two types of interest. We have simple interest and we have compound interest. And it's very important that you understand the difference between those two. Simple interest is computed on principal only. Remember, we have a principal and we have interest. It's only computed on principal only. And here's the formula for it. Interest equal to the principal, which is what we borrowed, times the interest rate, or what we invested. It doesn't matter whether we borrowed or we invested, times time. So P times I times N. To remember the formula interest, it's PIN. Your PIN for your debit card, right? PIN for your debit card. So if you borrow $10,000 for 3 years at 5%, here's what's going to happen. Time is 3, period is 3. The interest rate is 5. The principal is 10. If we use PIN, 10,000 times 5% times 3 will equal to 1,500. If you borrowed now $10,000 for 3 months, so notice the difference, for only 3 months, not 3 years, at 5%, you have to be careful with the time. Now we have to prorate the time. We have 10,000 times 5%. The time is not 3. The time is 3 divided by 12. I did this on purpose to kind of show you, you multiply it by 3 divided by 12. What do I mean by 3 divided by 12? 3 divided by 12, it means I have 3 out of 12 months in the year. Therefore, 3 divided by 12 is the proper time, not 3. So be careful whether you are giving a yearly or less than a year. Always, if the interest rate is for less than a year, it will be prorated, just like this one. For example, if it's 6 months, 6 out of 12. If it's daily, for example, if it's for 40 days, you divide it, 40 divided by 365. If you are told to use 360, you would use 360. So simply put, the simple interest rate here is, we took 10,000 times 5%, 10,000 times 5%, 10,000 times 5%. So we only use the principal amount, and we earned in total 1,500 and the bank paid 1,500 if you want to look at it from a bank perspective. Compounding interest is different. Compounding interest is when you would compute the interest on both the principal and the interest, and we're assuming here the interest is not taken out. It means the interest stayed at the bank like a CD and it will compound interest where you don't take the money out, you don't withdraw it. And for our purposes in intermediate accounting or any other course, the assumption is it's compounded, it's not taken out. Okay, so let's take a look now at this $10,000 if it's compounded, the same $10,000 that we invested for 3 years. Here's what's going to happen. The first year, it's going to earn 5%. It's going to earn $500. We're going to have, at the end of the year, $10,500. The second year, we're going to start with $10,500 because we did not take the money out. And this is the idea of compounding. It's going to earn 5%. We're going to earn $525. Again, we're going to keep this money, and we're going to add the $525 to the $10,500. Now we have $11,025. We're going to take this $11,025 multiplied by 5%. We're going to have $551.25. We're going to add this amount to the principal, and we're going to have now $11,576 and, to be specific, 25 pennies. In total, we earned $1,576, which is how much more? Which is $76.25 more than the simple interest. Now you're talking, it's not that much of a difference in a 3 year period. But if you take those numbers and add zeros to them, then you're talking in millions and billions in terms of interest. And this is how you should be thinking about. Now there is a formula to compute the compound rate. And it goes something like this: 1 plus I raised to the nth power, which is to come up with the future value factor for any particular period at I interest rate. For example, here, if we want to use our example, 1 plus, which is 1 plus, our interest rate is 0.05. And if you want to compute this for 3 years, because we'll go up to 3 years, because think about it, if you're computing compounding, you don't want to keep, you know, adding the principal, adding the interest to the principal, it takes a long time. Therefore, what you can do is you can use this formula, and basically we're going to take 1.05 raised to the third power, and that's going to give us 1.157625 if we multiply this by $10,000. And we know that we would receiving 11,576, which is how much we would receive for this loan. Let me keep the calculator up because we will need it anyway. So let's see. Yeah, we'll need it. So for example, if you want to do this computation for 5 years, 1.05 raised to the fifth power, in 5 years you multiply it by 10,000 and you will have 12,762, so on and so forth. So this is how you will compute the compounding rate. Let's talk more about the compound interest. Well, interest is expressed in terms of annual rate. So they would say the interest is 10%. But the period doesn't have to be a year. So although they tell you it's 10%, but the compounding can occur less than a year. Remember, compounding is when you earn interest on the interest and the principal, on both. And what happens is you can compound the interest throughout the year. When that happens, you have to convert the annual rate into a compounding rate. And how do you do that? You will take the annual rate and you'll divide it by the number of periods. And you have to determine the proper number of periods. Now, because you have the period is less than a year, you will take the number of periods times the compounding period. Let's take a look at an example to illustrate this concept. Let's assume we invested this $10,000 at 5% compounded semi-annually. Remember, the $10,000 earned us $500 in the prior example. Now it's compounded semi-annually. It means we have two periods. Why? Because the year have two periods, semi-annually, 2 6-month, and the rate now, we're going to divide the rate by two. So annual rate divided by the number of period, the number of period is two, it's 2.5%. The number of periods, which is 1 year times two, equal to two compounding period. Therefore, here's what's going to happen. We're going to have this money. We're going to start with $10,000. The first 6 months, it's going to earn $250. After a 6 month later, we're going to have $10,250, and this $10,250, it's going to earn again 5%, and it's going to earn $256.26. So notice, if we add them up, it's going to add up to $506.26. It's more than the $500 if the interest was compounded only once. So here's what we have. Here's how we convert. If you are told a 12% compounded over 5 years, if the interest rate is compounded annually, the period is five years, interest rate is 12%. Why? Because it's compounded annually. If you are told 12% over 5 years compounded semi-annually, the interest rate is not 12, the interest rate is 6%. Why? Because you have to divide the divided by 2. So the interest rate 12 divided by 2 semi-annually. And the number of periods, we have 5 years, but we have 2 periods in each year, the period equal to 10. If you are told the interest rate is compounded for this example semi-annually, you got quarterly, 12 divided by 4, the interest rate is 3. And quarterly, we have 4 quarters in a year times 5 years, n equal to 20. If you are told it's monthly, well, monthly means the interest rate is 1, because 12% divided by 12 equal to 1% divided by 12 month. And we have 12 month in a year times 5 years equal to 60. So you have to be very careful adjusting I and adjusting N when you are doing this computation. This is very important. I just want to make sure I emphasize this enough. You have to know how to do those computation. You have to know how to do this. Now, notice the interest rate is $506, which is more than the $500. So you would earn more. The more it's compounded, the better off you are. Now, we can compute what you actually earned. You earned 5.06 because you earned $506.26 and you invested $10,000. So notice, we call this 5.06 is the effective rate. You effectively earned not $5, not 5%, you effectively earned 5.06. So the 5% that we quoted invested at compounded semi-annually is called the nominal or the stated rate, but you effectively earned 5.06. Now, the more the compound occur, the higher is your return, the higher is the effective rate. And to compute the effective rate, basically you will take 1 plus I raised to the n power minus 1. Okay, so let's assume we're gonna go back to this $10,000 investment. How can we compute this? Well, if it's compounded annually, easy, 10,000 times 10%. Now, what happened if it's compounded semi-annually? Well, let's find the effective interest rate using this formula. Now, this is how we compute the effective interest rate. 1 plus, now you have to be careful, the interest rate here has to be adjusted rather than 10%, it's going to be 5%. So it's going to be 0.05 because it's semi-annually, equal to 1.05 raised to the second power minus 1 will give us 0.1025. It means you would earn 10.25%. So you will earn, rather than $1,000, if you invested $10,000, if the compounding was semi-annually, the effective rate is 10.25. Therefore, you will earn, rather than $1,000, you will earn 1,025. Let's assume it is compounded quarterly. So the rate is 10%, but compounded quarterly. Well, compounded quarterly means what? Well, quarterly, it means 4 times a year. If we take 10% divided by 4, it's going to be 2.5. So the interest rate that we're going to be using, 2.5. Okay? So let's do this computation. 1.025, 1 plus the I, raised, we're going to raise this to the number of periods. Quarterly means 4 periods, minus 1, and that's going to give us 10.38, which is 10.38%. 10.38% will give you a return of 1,038. Notice, the more this money is compounded, so on a timeline, it looks something like this. This is what we're saying on a timeline. If it's compounded annually, it's only 1 period. If it's compounded semi-annually, it means you earned interest for this period, you stop, you add the interest to the principal, then you will earn more interest on both the original principal and the interest. If it's compounded quarterly, 1, 2, 3, 4. So after 1 quarter, you would stop, earn the interest, add it to the principal, and earn interest on the principal and the interest. Quarterly two, you would stop the second quarter. You do the same thing. You will add the interest to the previous interest and to the principal, so on and so forth. And that's why you will earn more. Now, if this was compounded monthly, we could also do it monthly. Same thing. It's going to be monthly 10.47%, which is you will earn $1,047. Actually, you can compute this daily. If you want daily, you would earn an effective rate of 10.52, and you will earn in total $1,052. Again, very important to understand, the more it compound, the more if you are investing, the more is the return. But if you are paying, for example, if you have a credit card and it's most credit cards, they compound daily. It means every day that goes by, the interest added to the interest, and they compute the interest based on the previous interest, so on and so forth. And that's why it goes quickly out of control. So this is the compound interest, simple versus compound interest. This is important. This is important stuff that you will need to know for the CPA exam as well as for your intermediate accounting course. At the end, I'm going to remind you, keep your CPA review course. I'm a useful addition to that course. I can help you understand the material better in a different way. Your risk with me is 1 month of subscription. That's all what your risk is. You pass your CPA exam once in your lifetime. Invest in yourself, study hard, good luck, and stay safe.